I'd like to start by just acknowledging my fear that I have a problem right to begin with. First, that's my slot. First, I get the talk immediately after lunch. Second, I get the talk immediately after the fantastic visualization and so on. So it's going to be a hard act to follow up on that. And third, remember who was talking here at this time yesterday? Jan Bosch. So you know, it's another hard act to follow. So I'm going to try my best, and I will do my best to do a Jan Bosch imitation somewhere in my talk. So if you leave you in suspense. Jan, you know, Jan Smith, first he said that this session has nothing to do with automation, but that's exactly the point of my talk. The central theme of my talk is about automation.
I didn't say that.
Okay. Okay, and then I was getting worried when he started talking that he might give my talk because he started talking about AI and machine learning, which is what my talk is about. But luckily he stopped and just in time. So first, opportunities. Well, here is a poster child for digitalization. There can't be any better example to say what digitalization is about and what opportunities it presents and what the possibilities are, and then the automated car, and especially in Gothenburg, because as many of you know, Volvo and Autoliv have set up a joint venture, Zenuity, in Gothenburg, focused on autonomous vehicles. And this is really, I think some people yesterday mentioned the slogan that data is the new oil. And this is really almost literally true here with the automated car. When you have all these sensors all around the car, that is what it runs on. And what does it drive on? The maps that it drives on, or also data. So the automated vehicle is a perfect example for the possibilities of digitalization. It's a perfect example for what is big data. Look at just get a sense of the amount of data that this set of sensors is going to gather. It's almost as impressive as the data we saw in the visualization talk. And it's the poster child for machine learning and artificial intelligence, because you're going to use that data in order to solve this problem of autonomous driving. The other example that we had lots of talks about yesterday was about manufacturing or industry 4.0. And here again, if you look at what are the driving forces? So this is a chart from McKinsey. For McKinsey thinks about Industry 4.0. And you look now at, it's big data, it's digitization, knowledge work, advanced analytics, advanced robotics. Industry 4.0 also has a lot to do machine learning and AI. Here's another thing. This is from Bloomberg Business. And this is a landscape of the most recent dynamic startup companies around the world. It's particularly US-centric. And then again, the thing to notice, if you go to the right-hand side, that's the technology stack, and you look at the technologies there, it has all to do with big data, data analytics, data capture, and so on and so forth. So what's the message? And you look at the application domains, this agriculture, education, investment, legal, personal, materials, finance, applications from all over the place. And so what's the message? And now I have to do the Jan Bosch imitation. So yesterday we heard a lot of talk about the importance of software for digitalization and for the opportunities it presents. And now I have to say that, well, it's not the same old software as we see before. This is about AI. I mean, all of these things, what do they have in common? Well, X is any of the things that you can talk about, legal, business, investment, or whatever. And then it's enabled by AI. So this is the message. It's not the software, it's the AI, stupid. So that now I'm done with the Jan Bosch imitation, so we can go back to the usual. So here's another chart from the Wall Street Journal. And this is also indicative of where things are going. So if they made an analysis of where things are today. So if you look at business analytics, well, already in use, and within the next 5 years, 61% of business is going to be centrally using business analytics. Machine learning, again, within the next 5 years, You'll have rapid adoption. Self-learning robots, maybe not so much in the immediate future, but it's happening. So again, the same message, AI and machine learning is going to have impact across a number of different application areas. So we heard yesterday, or even today morning, that the importance, well, Jan Bosch said it yesterday, and today morning, Daria, we heard saying that the important thing for, well, both businesses and academia is you need to change. And this is true for us in university. We are often accused of being too static and not changing as fast as businesses do. Well, we are happy to say that here we did react and respond fast. So this is a project that we have been running over the last 5 years called Data-Driven Secure Business Intelligence, funded by the SSF. And essentially, it's within this project in the last 5 years that we've built up our machine learning and AI capabilities. So if I go back 10 years, I think I was also perhaps not as skeptical as Jan Smith, but I also, coming from a theoretical computer science and algorithms background, I might have also had skeptical things to say about artificial intelligence 10 or 15 years ago, but we realized at least 5-6 years ago that times are changing, taking another slogan from yesterday. And so we reacted quickly and we built up a machine learning and AI capability. And I think today we can say that amongst all across Sweden, we could claim today in Gothenburg to have one of the strongest groups in machine learning and AI. And distinguishing thing for our group is that we cover a very wide range of methods in artificial intelligence and AI. So some people today, if you look at the news, you might come away with the impression that machine learning is all deep learning, because that's what is dominating the news today. But actually, machine learning has many other things. It's a wide body of methods that come from statistics and probability, from optimization, computer science, algorithms, large-scale systems. And we have built up a very broad capability. Our faculty, we've recruited new faculty, and we're currently extending that recruitment to get a very wide coverage of machine learning areas. And so we have the two sides here. So on the left side, I can point to that we have been, over the last few years, having regular presence at NIPS, ICML, AAAI, KDD. These are the absolute top venues in machine learning, artificial intelligence, data mining. And we have our group has publications on a regular basis in these venues. And the areas I marked in red, these are the areas that we are currently very focused on. So deep learning, because it has had a huge impact recently. But we also have a capability, I think the leading capability within Sweden, at least, in reinforcement learning. We have a lot of work in differential privacy that you heard about in the morning. From a machine learning standpoint, in the morning you might have heard, got the more programming language view on it. But we have a lot of work going on in machine learning using differential privacy. And a new area that we've just started with one of our PhD students, who is now a postdoc in MIT, is around a new area which focuses on causality, which is somebody in the lunch break was asking about machine learning is sometimes thought of as a black box, gives you an answer, yes or no, but no understanding. That's not really true. That's a misconception of machine learning, but in particular, this new area is focused on getting more explanatory messages from machine learning, and we're investing in that. On the right-hand side, there are two examples of recent projects. The first one is with Volvo Cars and Zenuity, and this is around autonomous driving, focusing on sensor modeling and prediction problems. And the second one, together with Fraunhofer Chalmers, is on the smart digital factory. So this is Industry 4.0, and this is together with SCOF and FlexLink, who are the two manufacturing partners in this. So these are the way at least we are reacting to the opportunities and trying to take advantage of them. And out of this project, we have also now launched a company. And the idea, so this is Data Intelligence Sweden. And the idea is that this company is located exactly halfway between research, which is our the university side, and industry, which now, as we've saw, is being driven by AI as the enabling technology. And what we want to do is to bridge this gap. We want to take our master students, who are very smart programmers, and we want to bring them into a level where they're intelligent and creative users of artificial intelligence, machine learning technologies. They can interact with on the from the research side, but then deliver the solutions that industry needs. So we have just started this company. We have a few customers, but we hope that this will enable us to have much better translation of the research results to industry. And that's what we aim to do. And you can talk to Hans Solomonsson, who has been working with us in our Big Data Chalmers initiative, and he's going to be the CTO of the company. And you can talk to him during the break to see what he's been up to with the company recently. Here's another example of but this is a different type of example. So this is a picture of an autonomous fleet. Let's say autonomous fleet of electric cars. So this is a little bit different from machine learning, because machine learning is when you have data, you've collected data from what you have, and you want to understand and get insights from it. But this is a problem about the future. What should the future look like when you have transport around, which is centered around a fleet of autonomous cars like this? What kind of city should you design? And you can't answer that question using machine learning because you don't have any data about the future. So how do we tackle a question like this? Where should we locate the charging infrastructure for this kind of autonomous fleet of cars in Gothenburg? So what we're doing for this is using large-scale agent-based simulations using what are called synthetic populations. So the idea is that you form a synthetic population of the city and about the kind of activities that people engage in, and you do a large-scale agent-based simulation using that, and that will give you an idea of where you can locate the infrastructure in the best possible way that, gives you the optimal coverage, causes least congestion, is best priced, and so on and so forth. And this is work that is also part of a center of excellence in global system science funded by the European Union, also partly by the SSF project, and we have Oscar Alabo, who might also be in the audience, who has been working on that, and you can talk to him. And here's an example of a synthetic population in Gothenburg, a picture of the households that we've built up, and here is a snapshot of a simulation. This is not a definitive result. It's just to give you an idea that when you run the model, here are some places it tells you there should be charging stations. And it makes sense if you look at think about where they're located. So this is work that we have just started, and we hope that we will get a lot of insights using these agent-based simulations with synthetic populations. OK, so those were the opportunities. Some of the opportunities, what are the challenges? So I have a colleague here with whom I've been having lots of arguments about this, but we won't get into that. This is the, you might have heard Elon Musk and Bill Gates and so on talking about super intelligence and the dangers. So my view on that is let's enjoy the movie, and it's nice enjoying the movie, and not much more to talk about that. But what I would like to instead talk about, the challenges have to do with automation as represented by this picture. And we are not the only ones, of course, because when President Obama, one of the few last interviews he did before leaving office, was he had a long interview with the Wired magazine, and he spent a lot of time talking also about this question about automation and what's going to happen to the economy and society as a large. And we wrote a viewpoint piece in the communications of the ACM. And so if you're interested in these kinds of questions, these two kinds of threats of AI, so the first one is called the technological singularity, when you get superintelligence, and the second one is called the economic singularity. We discuss a little bit of that in this viewpoint piece, and be happy to have discussions with those of you who are interested in that. But this view, when Jan Bosch was giving his talk, he mentioned that he dismissed us negativos for talking about this. But I'd like to respond by saying we are not negativos, we are realisticos. And these books have brought up this issue. So this book in particular, The Second Machine Age, written by a couple of MIT economists, and this is by a computer professional, and this is the Swedish version, written by Stefan Folster, who's a well-known economist. So they've brought it up as a credible threat that one should consider over the next 2 decades. You might have up to 50% of the currently existing jobs disappearing. Now, I know that Jan Bosch said, don't worry about it, there will be many other jobs coming up, but I think it's not so one can't be so quick in dismissing it out of hand. If you read these books, they do consider the usual questions. Why is this time different? I mean, technology has always displaced people, so this will be the same. Why should it be different? Computers will give rise to many new jobs that we can't even imagine today. That's also possible. They discuss that. And despite the fact that they're all well aware of these arguments, they still think it's something that we should give some thought to. There's a slightly facetious and provocative statement here by another guy who wrote a recent bestseller. He says, the great problem of 21st century economics is what to do with surplus humans. So as technologists, what could be a response to this? And that's going back in a dialectic back to opportunities. And one view on that is, and this is the name we started this symposium, digitalization symposium, with yesterday, with Doug Engelbart, and I'm going back to Doug Engelbart now, because in his view, what we should talk about is not AI, but IA, which is intelligence automation. And this is a nice recent book which gives a perspective on that. And the idea is conveyed by this picture here. So Jan mentioned that now Garry Kasparov was beaten by a computer, and the computer is the best chess player. But actually, that's not true. The best chess player today is neither a man nor a machine. It's a combination of man and machine. That's the best chess player today. And so that's the vision of what are called cognitive assistants. We heard about that in the talk of Anders Ginnerman. And this message should complement what he was talking about. He was talking about the visualization aspects of it. And what I'm interested in is the cognitive aspects, what makes this assistant intelligent. And so this is the quote of Doug Engelbart, that what you want is, do you want to combine the capabilities that humans are good at, creative capabilities, and things that machines are good at, automated tasks? And that's what a cognitive assistant should be. And that should really extend our abilities to collaborate and solve more complex problems. So today, of course, many of us do use cognitive assistants, Siri, Cortana, Amazon Echo, and so on, but the vision is you want all-pervasive cognitive computing. And the best example, of course, is the Watson doctor that Jan mentioned. So a doctor coming up, you know, a new patient comes to a doctor, it's very hard to make a diagnosis because he has a very strange kind of condition, and he might need to recall similar cases or cases somewhere else in the world. It's going to be very hard for a doctor to do that by himself, but if he had a cognitive assistant helping him, he could have instantly at his disposal all the similar cases around the world, their complete record, their treatment, the response, and that would help him make a much better diagnosis. So this is a perfect example of combining the best capabilities of humans and computers in order to solve a complex problem. And hopefully, this is what we will see over the next couple of decades, all-pervasive cognitive agents solving very complex problems in society, not just the simple problems that we have today, or the ones they are solving today. But what do we need in order to get this technology to work with the cognitive computing? So at least these two technologies are going to be critical. Natural language processing, you want to be able to communicate with these cognitive agents, and you need interaction, feedback, learning from the environment. At least these two technologies are going to be absolutely key. And also, in general, if you say, what are the key new tech, if you want to say, where is AI going? What's the next step to the next version of AI, the next advances? NLP and interaction, feedback, learning, this is certainly the key new elements that AI and machine learning have to develop. And here is a simple example to show why natural language is a very good paradigm example. So here are two sentences that, as humans, we understand perfectly and very easily, but if a machine had to understand these language, these sentences, it's much more complicated. So we understand very quickly that In the first sentence, the word bank refers to the riverbank, and the word dough refers to money. But in the second sentence, she went to the bank and took out some money. This bank refers to the other kind of bank, and money refers to dough, to the same object. So this is an example to show how understanding natural language is a very complex cognitive task. And so in solving this problem, as Anna also mentioned, involves very complex semantic reasoning. And this is a challenging problem for AI and machine learning, and certainly will be key to this cognitive technology we are looking for. Digitalization has been one of the key drivers in the NLP revolution. And we've all seen Google Translate, and this is a picture of some of the recent performances showing very close to perfect translation. Now, we did see that there were some, it's not quite to human level, but it's still pretty impressive. And the example of translation from Swedish to the latest Google Translate is improvement over the previous generation in comparison to a human translation. It's again quite impressive. But it's still far from perfect. So here's an example. Yeah. So Anna gave you some examples. Here's another example. The Google Translate gets terribly wrong. And this example is particularly interesting for us because the mistake here has to do with the translation of the word field, which has different meanings. And this is illustrated by this cartoon here. So the word rock can mean different things in different contexts. And unfortunately, this kid is really in her world here at the moment, not quite the answer that the examiner was asking. So distinguishing different senses of words is one of the key elements in natural language understanding. And this is a problem that we have worked on together with our local industry partner, Recorded Future, because they have to do this all the time when they're collecting information from the web. And what we've done is we've used a machine learning technique called word embeddings that have a way that natural language is represented as points in Euclidean space, and reasoning is done in the space in order to capture the meaning of languages, of sentences. And here's an example of work that was done by two of our PhD students and a colleague of mine together with them. And this shows that for the word power, we automatically induce the different word senses. So we can recover that there is a sense of power that means energy unit. That's one sense in which power is used. And there's another sense of power as political and government senses. So this method automatically, by just looking at text, is able to infer that there are several different senses in which this word could be used. We can also disambiguate. So if you feed in a sentence, he sat on the river bank and counted his dough, what does this word bank, which sense does it correspond to? Well, we can tell you that this corresponds to the body of water, the land beside the body of water. This was work done by Mikkel, another of our PhD students, and Hans, who I mentioned before. So these are examples that, again, they are the state of the art for these two problems in word sense induction and word sense disambiguation. And these are illustrative of some of the key problems in natural language technology that now machine learning and artificial intelligence is able to address that could not be done or was done far less successfully by previous methods that did not use this data-driven technologies. The older methods using grammar and so on, they don't do as well at these tasks as these methods. Of course, you can combine and take advantage of both kinds of methods as well. Here's another example from the work that we're doing. This is about information overload. So you have, this is like the Watson example. You have lots of documents related to the problem at hand, but you'd like a quick way to understand what this is about. You want a quick summary of this information. So this is a problem of words of document summarization, and we have now a system, again, from work of two of our PhD students, that automatically from a bunch of documents can extract a summary that tells you what these documents were really about. And you can try it out. It's available as a tool both on our website and also at our partners in the project. You can fill in your text here, and out here will be a short summary of what this text is about. So this is another example of using machine learning and artificial intelligence methods in order to create a technology that perhaps a cognitive assistant, such as the one we talked about, might. So this is a long-term vision that language technology is a much bigger problem that we hope to have solved in a much more comprehensive way in the future. It's one of our target and focus areas in the group. And since Anna is there, I have to cut short the last part, which had to do with reinforcement learning. Let me quickly, I'll do that very quickly, because Jan actually mentioned this problem Go, and he said, and this is Atari games. And both of these were solved by DeepMind, the Google company DeepMind. And the key technology, key machine learning technique that was involved in solving this had to do with reinforcement learning. And this is the type of machine learning that enables you to learn from the environment and predict what is the right move to make in chess. And depending on what you do, you get a response and you react further. So we have been working on this in our group, and we applied it to this game. It's not as complicated in some sense as Go, but it's complicated in a different way. So this is particularly good in the Swedish context because it's a famous, very popular game among Swedish kids. So this is a master student, and together with our PhD student, they have a system that plays this game. So you know, you have to guess who this character is on the other side. And this is a bit different from the examples earlier, because this is interaction with two people who are trying to solve to play this game. So it's a multi-agent system that does communication and interaction, learning, feedback in order to play this game. So let me summarize and say that data science, machine learning, cognitive computing, they're poised to play an all-pervasive role in this fast-approaching automated economy and society that's enabled by digitalization. And for us, we think that natural language processing, reinforcement learning, these will be key technologies in developing some of these new cognitive computing methods. Thanks.
Thank you, Devdatt. Thank you. Very interesting. And so many things. I want to ask several things, but I'm going to allow one short question from the audience, if there is one. Yes. Yes, please.
Has there been anyone in the world who have been asking himself if it's possible to build in ethics or moral in artificial intelligence?
Yeah, this is a question that many people have been asking, actually. It's there's even a new institute that was set up by Elon Musk called the Future of Life Institute. And the mandate of this institute is essentially how to make a benign, a good AI as opposed to, you know, an evil, malignant AI. So, yes, there have been many people asking these questions, and this Future of Life Institute is a very serious endeavor because they've, you know, Elon Musk has put a huge amount of money in there, and there are many good researchers associated with the institute. How exactly it is going to be done, probably none of us have a very good idea about that. How do you instill AI ethics into AI systems? I think this is a little bit beyond the scope of what we're able to even imagine doing at the moment, but people have been thinking about it, so let's see where we go with that. On the other hand, if you meant by AI or the ethics, you meant questions like what Daria was referring to, which is much more practical questions about the misuse of AI and the biases that AI systems. That's another different issue, but that we have more concrete solutions to. So you want to maybe do a classification, but you don't want to do classification of people which is biased racially or ethnically, and you want your methods to be resistant to such kind of biases. There's concrete work on that we know how to tackle.